We have two speakers for today. The first speaker, the two speakers are Rajat Chavla, who is a partner at an Indian firm called JP Chavla and Co. LLP. He's a lead partner over there for transfer pricing, international tax, and foreign exchange law. Rajat has been involved in managing transfer pricing documentation and tax litigation of many M&Es. He has been successfully advising companies with global operations in designing their TP, international tax, and foreign exchange laws and policies, and enabling them complete life cycle support for transfer pricing processes, starting from documentation to assessment and ending with litigation. Our second speaker of today is Virender Sharma, who's a partner at Transfer Pricing Associates. Virender has an overall experience of over 15 years of working in UK, India, US, and the Netherlands. He's been working in the field of transfer pricing for the last 13 years in the areas of planning, documentation, and controversy with major organizations and multinational companies to develop practical transfer pricing strategies. Virender has a significant exposure in dispute resolution, including assisting clients before commissioner appeals and tax tribunals and mutual agreement procedures. We will now introduce you to the agenda of the presentation. I request you to keep all your questions for the end, where we will have a separate Q&A session. You can also type in your questions as comments, but we will address them at the end of the presentation. I now invite Rajat to start with the agenda of the presentation.
So, you know, the agenda for today's webinar is that we will start with giving you an overview of transfer pricing in India. Then we will also discuss about a new regulatory aspect introduced in transfer pricing, that is APA. We will also discuss about safe harbor rules in India. We will also discuss about briefly about range concept, APA rollback, and multiple year data. Virender will also take you through key controversial issues which are highly litigated in India, i.e. share valuation, location saving, intangibles, management charges, contract research and development. Then we will also discuss about, you know, how you can mitigate your litigations, few key measures. Now I will request Avisha to start with the first slide, which basically gives you an overview of transfer pricing in India after the abbreviations. So, the transfer pricing in India resulted due to the fact that our economy opened up in late 1990s, and we had a lot of FDI coming into India. With FDI, there was a presence of M&Es in India. Once M&Es were there, then, you know, the IRA started the allegation that the profits which are due to India are being shifted to low tax jurisdictions. So they introduced a transfer pricing regime in year 2001. Indian transfer pricing regime basically mechanically talks about determination of arm's length prices through six methods, which are CUP, CPM, TNMM, PSM, and RPM, and lately introduced any other method. In the regulations, there is no hierarchy in selecting the most appropriate method. Basically, the most appropriate method depends on aspects related to functional analysis and comparability. Indian TP regulations also talk about detailed and contemporaneous documentation. They also require you to file an accountant's report in Form 3CEB before filing your income tax return, which is currently November 30th. Regulations also provide you with a tolerance band of 1% for wholesale traders and 3% for other taxpayers when it comes to arithmetic mean. Lately, the Indian transfer pricing regime to be in sync with international standards have also introduced range and multiple year concepts, which we will briefly talk about later. Now, you know, if you don't comply with Indian TP provisions, it can lead to stringent consequences. Penalty rates are quite high, even higher than US. So, you know, if there's an adjustment in your transfer pricing audit, it is treated as concealment of income. The penalty can range from 100% to 300% of tax on the additions made or the adjustments made. There are also penal consequences if you do not file your annual annual report, transfer pricing report. So, you know, as you all know, you know, India is just an observer to OECD. So, but when it comes to DP regulations, we are largely aligned with OECD DP guidelines, especially once we have introduced now range concept and the multiple year concept. Although we are not obliged to follow OECD principles, but OECD principles do have persuasive value when it comes to court of law. I request, please turn over to the next slide.
Hi, good morning, good afternoon, good evening to everyone. This is Virendra. Rajat, one point I need your insight into is that although the situation in India came in the year 2001, my understanding that the regulation was still in existence even before 2001. So, is it right to say that although the regulation was there, but from 2001 onwards, it was more detailed in terms of we had detailed rules and much wider regulation on transfer pricing 2001 onwards. So what's your view on that?
Yeah, you know. So, you know, the after 2001, you know, because, you know, we had a lot of FDI coming in and a lot of MNEs in picture. So the government decided to formalize the DP regime and tried to, you know, basically align it with, although they were not successful in aligning it with international standards. But they did try to align it with international standards and brought in various formal rules. So, you know, practically speaking, the litigation started after these rules started. So 2001 was a decisive year in, you know, the transfer pricing regime in India.
Thanks, Rajat.
So, you know, considering litigation, we also do have certain positive aspects of, you know, Indian transfer pricing regulations that you can see on the slide. For avoidance of disputes, we have lately introduced advanced pricing agreement regime. We also introduced safe harbor rules, although, you know, safe harbor rules we will discuss later are not as, you know, are not accepted by the industry as they should have been. For resolution of disputes, we have something known as dispute resolution panel, which is basically a committee of commissioners. Currently, we have five DRPs in the country. You know, a DRP is, you know, something which is a time-based dispute resolution mechanism. The regulations give 9 months to DRP dispute resolution panels to basically dispose the matters. So you have some kind of certainty that your dispute would be resolved within a particular period. Vis-a-vis, you know, if you go to, you know, there's another, you know, forum where you can appeal your dispute, that is commissioner appeals. Although, you know, the regulations, though not mandatory, give a 1 year period to commissioner appeals to basically dispose the matters. But generally it has been seen it does take 2 to 3 years to dispose matters with commissioner appeals. After commissioner appeals, you have other legal forums in India known as Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, where which is the last fact-finding authority in India, where you can appeal any dispute in your TP matter. You can also go to High Court, to Supreme Court. But considering, you know, the disputes are at a larger scale in India, you end up, you know, litigating for at least 7 to 8 years. So another resolution, another mechanism to resolve your disputes is invoking MAP, which is a good strategy, but, you know, considering high and aggressive tax demands in India. You know, as some of the treaties also provide for staying of demands, like, you know, United Kingdom, US and Denmark do provide, you know, if you invoke MAP, your demand would be stayed. But then again, you know, MAP is a, you know, a longer process, and it does take time to resolve your disputes through MAP. You know, Coming to benchmarking databases which are available in India, although the regulations don't provide for any benchmarking databases, but generally two databases are preferred both by IRA and the taxpayer. That is Provis and Capitalline. There are other databases which are also available, but they are not as famous as Provis and Capitalline, and IRA generally use Provis and Capitalline. So if you see the last two points on the slide, this will give you an overview about transfer pricing adjustments in India. In financial year 2013, we had TP adjustments as huge as $1.16 billion, which is quite huge. And if you see the issues which were involved during the litigation, although Vendor will discuss these issues later, but if giving you statistics, in 38% of cases the disputes evolved around selection of appropriate comparable companies, which is quite basic. And although now we feel that because we have introduced multiple year data and range concept, selection of appropriate comparable companies won't be a big issue, but still this regulation needs to be seen how the IRA takes and evolves this regulation. 13% in case of 13% cases, the issue was computation of profit level indicator, that is PLI. In 9% of cases, selection, the issue was selection of most appropriate method. And 8% of cases, you had intra-group services and their commercial expediency as an issue when you saw the jump to 54% transfer pricing adjustments in audit cycle 2013. We also had certain high-profile cases like Shell and Vodafone, which I think will be taken later. Now there's a positive environment which is being created in India when it comes to tax disputes. We now see that transfer pricing adjustments have dropped by 22% in 2014-15. Still, the number still remains high. That is $7.14.86 million vis-a-vis 13-14 audit cycle. But still, this is quite positive as compared to 2013, and we expect, as our TP regime develops further, we will have lesser adjustments, and we will only have adjustments where there is a genuine case.
Rajat, I remember a couple of years back when I was in India, and during that point in time, dispute resolution panel appeal mechanism was introduced. And during those days, I still remember that the taxpayer, in many cases, they opted for DRP route to address their appeal position. But then during those days, I think in most of the cases, the judgment was not passed in favor of taxpayer and the case went to tribunal. But when I I'm sitting today, when I look at as a taxpayer, whether I should go ahead and choose DRP or CIT appeal, what will be your recommendations based on your practical experience in India? Because DRP has its own advantages and it has three commissioners who are looking after the appeal. So what's your experience? That would you recommend one of the two appeal options to the taxpayer, or it is entirely based on facts of the case?
So, there are two answers. One, it is entirely based on facts. The second answer is, personally speaking, I will, currently prefer CIT appeals because DRP have commissioners which are basically part of the, the TP regime or the transfer pricing officers. Although lately we have got certain, positive aspects in this area as well, where in certain instructions or certain regulations have been made where, DRP panel has been expanded and separate commissioners have been used for DRP. But still, it's at a very nascent stage and we need to see, how this evolves. But if you see the last 2 years trend, people more or less prefer CIT appeals rather than DRP. The reason being DRP commissioners were part of the transfer pricing audits as well. So it doesn't make sense, you know, to, it's kind of another, you know, TP audit happening after a TPO, you know, rather than going to a separate, you know, appellate or, you know, a separate person to explain your case.
Thanks, Rajat.
So coming to next slide, you know, this is something very new and, you know, exciting, which has come in, you know, the transfer pricing regime in India, that is advanced pricing agreement. It has been like a silver lining for taxpayer considering, you know, there's a huge tax demand pending and the approach of TPOs have been very aggressive. You know, India is the only country where TPOs have been given target to collect revenue, so which has not been seen anywhere else in the world. So APA basically gives you some kind of a certainty that your prices will not be challenged. So when we come to Indian APA regime, we have three kind of APAs in India. One is unilateral, another is bilateral, and third is multilateral. I think these are self-explanatory. When do you prefer an APA? Generally, APAs are preferred when you have complex or high-volume transactions, but then you need to make your internal cost-benefit analysis. There is no specific limit in the regulations, but ideally you need to see internally or the facts of your transactions determine whether you want to go for an APA or you don't want to go for an APA. If for future, you know, APA has a validity of a maximum 5 years as per the law. Lately, the APA regime positively has also introduced something known as rollback. You can roll back your APA up to 4 years. So, you know, considering 5 years for future and 4 years for you know, past, it basically gives you 9 years of certainty. So, which is quite positive. You know, in an APA, you can also, you know, file an anonymous application, you know, and discuss with the IRA your business structure and everything, so that without disclosing your business or your business name. Post an APA, although an annual compliance is necessary every year. Now to coming to the APA process. APA process has been divided into four stages. One is the first is the pre-filing stage, which basically you discuss your international transactions with the IRA, your business setup, your economic analysis, without disclosing, you have an option not to disclose your business name. Then when you're certain that you want to go for an APA, then the formal submission stage, you pay a particular fee and you formally submit an application for APA. The next stage, the negotiation stage, which is the most time-consuming stage in an APA process and the most important stage in the APA process, you negotiate your agreement with the IRA. And then once you have negotiated, you basically finalize the agreement.
Rajat, one point on APA which I want to make is that APA is a very important tool when I actually explore at bilateral level a certificate I have to control my double tax. It should happen that I have a unilateral APA in X country and in my country, you know, the tax authorities, they don't like my pricing, which is agreed in X country, and then I have a double tax. Now, looking at unilateral, to my mind, unilateral makes sense. When a local company in India, which is a foreign subsidiary of a foreign company, doesn't have big operations and it's not very, very substantial in the overall financial space of the MNC. So unilateral makes sense.
Supply chain.
But bilateral is important when the transaction values are very heavy for the Indian company with overseas group company. So what is your experience in India has been? Have you also seen many bilateral APAs in India? And is there any multilateral APA signed already in India?
So the, you know, giving you statistics, you know, we have had, 550 APA applications since last 3 years. And out of that, you know, 12 unilateral APAs have been concluded and two bilateral APAs have been concluded, i.e. With the taxpayer in UK and Japan. So, you know, we didn't have any multilateral API as yet.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Yeah. So, coming to the next slide, which basically speaks about, you know, what APA requires agreement on. So, these are the indicative points, you know, which basically the APA generally requires agreement upon selection and application transfer pricing method, that is the most appropriate method, deciding on the years over which comparable results are going to be analyzed. Adjusting the comparable results, you need to decide in the APA how you're going to adjust the comparable results and test the results during the APA period. You also, you know, need to decide upon your critical assumptions because, you know, if your critical assumptions are go wrong, then, you know, it defeats the whole process of the agreement. So to facilitate, you know, coming to the next point, to facilitate the taxpayer, the Central Board of Direct Taxes has also developed a model APA template on which, you know, you further work upon and, you know, you have your bespoke agreement. Now, because APA involves a lot of exchange of sensitive information and India does have a Right to Information Act as well. So, generally there is no firewall, you know, when you share your sensitive information with the APA members, you know. Generally, although, you know, the APA members are quite senior IRA officials, but there is no provision in the law for a firewall. Now, through press reports, we also have come to know that Indian government is also examining a scope of bilateral APAs, even when their relevant DDAA doesn't have Article 9.2. Although you can also have synthetic APAs. Vendor, would you like to speak on synthetic APAs?
Yes, sure, Arjit. Yeah. Now, when we look at this Article 9.2 in double tax treaty, now, in some certain countries, India doesn't have this Article 9.2, and in that situation, it's difficult for India to have discussion to agree on bilateral APA with another country. So, one practical and viable option is that both countries, which is the India and as well as foreign countries, say Germany, the company in both countries talk to the tax authorities in their in the local country and they agree a unilateral APA at the same time. So which means that we are locking the same transaction at unilateral level in both countries. So which in a way translates into a kind of a synthetic APA. So it's not exactly a bilateral APA. The way we understand where we have competing authorities, they talk to each other. It's like I'm locking on the same transaction from both sides by doing unilateral APA at the same time in two countries. And that is we call synthetic APA. But Rajat, I believe that India has not moved to synthetic APA so far in India.
Yeah, you know, we don't see this. But this is quite a good mechanism where you can lock your prices from both sides. And it is less time consuming if you compare with time taken by bilateral APAs.
And Rajat, one point I have, it's more like practical point. When I deal with the APA authorities here in Europe, I've seen that we agree on some level of profitability for the taxpayer who's entering into an APA with the APA authority. And at times we agree some level of markup over the years, but then that markup is actually based on what comparables are throwing. But when I look at India, we have other options also like safe harbor, and in India the adjustment has been where the tax authorities has taken the expected markup to a very high level during litigation. Even in safe harbor, the markup's expectation is very high. So I'm saying is APA, when I go for an APA, do I agree a markup which is actually a right markup, or is it like there's an expectation of a higher markup for the APA by the APA authorities?
So, you know, practically speaking, in the current APA, we are fortunate that, you know, the APA teams have been very transparent in negotiation. So they are not aggressively, you know, they are not given targets to basically, you know, our CPOs have been given targets to collect revenue. So they discuss everything with you. So they understand your business, they understand your economic analysis, they understand your industry, they understand your functional analysis, which has been a key part of litigation all across in the Indian TP regime. And then they basically arrive and validate and verify your FAR and economic analysis, and then agree to certain approach which needs to be taken into advanced pricing agreements.
Okay, thanks, Rajat.
Yeah. So now coming to the next slide, please. So, you know, this is just statistics which speaks about that India was the first country to sign APA in the first year of implementation. APAs have been, you know, a biggest advantage when it comes to transfer pricing because, A, they are, you know, less time consuming vis-a-vis, you know, the long litigation process in India, which essentially takes 7 to 8 years, in some cases 12 years as well. So if you see, we have had the 550 APA applications, you know, I think the latest number is 12 unilateral and 2 bilateral APAs. The issues which have been involved in APAs generally revolve around captive centers, say a share valuation, you know, although our courts have also positively decided in favor of taxpayer in case of share valuations, which I think Virendra will discuss with you later. Royalty, management fees, interest payments, extension of corporate guarantees, and contract manufacturing. So, you know, the sectors, if you see, you know, the sectors which have approached for APA have been telecom, oil and gas, pharma, software development, BPOs. So roughly 40% of applications, I'll give you another statistic, roughly 40% of applications have come from IT, oblique IT sector, because this is the biggest sector in India where M&Es are there in India.
And Rajat, I'm not sure if I missed that point. Generally, how much time it takes to have unilateral APA started and completed in India?
So if you see the statistics in last 3 years, you know, you had 550 applications and only 12 unilateral APAs have been concluded. So I will practically say 2 to 3 years, you know, depending upon how you're able to explain your facts to IRAs, how much cooperative you are with IRA, how much transparent you are with IRA, or IRA, you know, you're able to understand, is able to understand your business, your economic analysis, your functional analysis.
Okay,
it's all fact-based, you know, and it depends on case-to-case.
Thanks, Rajat.
So coming to the next slide, I think I briefly discussed this, you know, before where Virendra had a discussion, you know, what are the positives or, you know, what are the practical aspects involved in APA negotiation. So I would only like to add another point that, you know, as compared to, you know, TPOs or, you know, the transfer pricing officers, the APA teams have been quite patient and proactive, and we have had, you know, the experts, the economic experts involved in APA teams who are ready to understand your business, who are ready to, you know, who are ready to be transparent with you in negotiations, and who are ready to examine the role of overseas enterprises in the transactions, and who are ready to understand the functional analysis, which has been the biggest source of litigation in India.
And Rajat, when I look at having dialogue with the APA authorities where we have to show facts and have discussion face to face, my experience has been that in many occasions I saw the global tech head or the CFO from the parent used to visit and had face to face talk with the APA authorities, and that used to give a kind of comfort and also the required knowledge which the APA authorities they look for. So what's your experience when we start having a dialogue with the APA authority in the initial stages, and also when we have to discuss about the case in detail? Do you suggest that it's important that there are people from the overseas office should also make a representation along with the Indian or people in India office of the company, so that, you know, they make a solid case before the APA authorities? Do you think it's that strategically a good choice which an MNC should be making?
So it's a matter of choice and fact-based thing. You know, if you want your, if you want that, you know, the APA team should really understand your business, it is always advisable that, you know, the senior employees of the company are involved, from the business side, are involved in the APA negotiation process, you know, because, you know, if you have tax heads and only the finance heads speaking to APA authorities, you don't really get the, you know, the crux of the business. You don't, the APA team generally doesn't get the, you know, the comfort while only dealing with finance and taxes. They really get the comfort when they really meet the business guys to understand the industry, the functional analysis in the particular, particular entity.
Yeah, thank you, Rajat.
So, you know, coming to the next slide, which is another, dispute avoidance measure, which was positively introduced by the Indian government on Indian Revenue Authorities on September 18, 2013. So, you know, if you can go through the slide, you know, basically the first part of slide, first part of the table of the slide tells you the sector, you know, where the safe harbors are there, and the second part tells you about the limits of international transactions, you know, and then the third part talks about the margins, you know, which are expected in a safe harbor. So if you see the safe harbor percentages, even on the next slide, you know, if you can turn on the next slide, please. Yeah. So if you see the margins in the safe harbor, part of the table, you see these are quite high margins, you know, and it does not basically practically reflect which is there in the industry. So factually and obviously, you know, the response to safe harbors have been very lukewarm, and they have not been a success. Can you please come to the next slide, please? So, you know, telling you more about safe harbor, you know, a taxpayer may opt for a safe harbor regime either for 1 or more years, subject to maximum period of 5 years, by furnishing relevant compliance forms. There is no adjustment for comparable allowance for range in safe harbor. Although you have a safe harbor, then also you need to have mandatory transfer pricing documentation and file the accountant's report in Form 3CEB. Now, you know, as I discussed, you know, the practical challenges which are involved in safe harbor is that, you know, there is no relaxation in documentation requirement. You know, even if you you have such a big margin, you should basically have a relaxation in documentation requirement. Now, another inconsistency in the ELP domain is that there are high margins, and you know, if you talk about the mirror image, these high margins may not be acceptable to foreign jurisdictions, which will practically lead to double taxation. Another weak area in the safe harbor regulations is that, you know, if you see the sectors, you know, you don't have a sector-wise definition. You know, you will always have overlapping sectors like ITES, KPOs, or even contract R&D or contract R&D in software services. There are no defined definitions. So the taxpayer is obviously confused, you know, and the which sector he should classify his business in, and which safe harbor is appropriate for him. So unless and until, you know, practically speaking, you know, the margins will not be made realistic, so we will not see the safe harbor regime practically, buoyant in the transfer pricing regime in India. So, coming to the next slide, please. So, you know, this slide basically talks about, you know, certain new areas which have been lately introduced in 2014, namely range concept, APA rollback, which we earlier discussed, and multiple year data. So, coming to the range concept, earlier, you know, we only used to have, arithmetic mean as against, you know, universal standard of interquartile range. But this has now been changed. We also have now the rules and regulations for the range concepts, which basically practically talks about, you know, how weights have to be assigned to various methods. Also suggests, you know, the arm's length percentile range, which is basically between 35th percentile to 65th percentile. It also talks about, you know, the median concept if your ALP is not falling between the 35 to 65% time. But you know, this has been a lately introduced concept and has been started from 1st April 2014. So we really need to see, you know, how it evolves. So another positive thing has been that multiple year data has been introduced, which basically syncs our transfer pricing regime with the international standards. We have already discussed about APR rollback. You can roll back up to 4 previous years, although there are certain conditions. And as the rules and regulations I've already discussed, they have all been notified, and they talk about the various concepts, how range can be applied, and how you can apply multiple year concepts. So it pretty much sums up.
One point on multiple year data, I believe that's doing multiple year analysis is very important when we apply economic principles to transfer pricing. And as you know that, you know, earlier only single year data was allowed. So based on the changes, is it right to say that now taxpayer can actually use 3 years data to draw a right economic understanding, because at times the profits are low because of cyclical reasons which may have only impacted the taxpayer. So just to be able to compare with the industry, the taxpayer now can look at 3 years data, but at the same time, can taxpayer is taxpayer also required to, or is allowed to also consider 3 years data for him also? Because if I compare multiple year with comparables, so is regulation allows taxpayer to look at 3 years data for its own situation?
So the regulations talk about that if you have entered the same kind of a transaction before as well. So, you know, generally they only talk about, you know, the comparable transactions. So, you know, the major challenge which I foresee, you know, when they give a range is, again, in comparability, you know. The DPO will always argue that, you know, even in a range, you know, a particular company is comparable or not, which will basically distort your, you know, the percentile range.
Okay, thanks, Rajat.
Yeah. So coming to the next slide, I think, Virinder, you would be starting with the key controversial issues.
Yes, Rajat. Thanks, Rajat. When I look at Indian TP regulation system, I will divide this, the whole experience in three periods. The first period, I start from 2001 to 2005, where the taxpayers were preparing documentation and they submitted their documentation to tax authorities, where the TP audits notice were issued. And during the first 5 years, the main issues which were discussed, they were about how much markup you are earning, how you're comparing yourself with comparable. So that was the initial phase of TP litigation in India. So there were a lot of discussion on basic concepts. Then I moved to the second phase of TP litigation experience in India, which is the next 5 years, which is from 2006 to 2010. And during second phase, we started seeing the tax authorities raising questions like if the Indian company was paying for the management services, are those costs were right, which were paid by India, whether Indian company was receiving benefits. In other occasions, the Indian tax authorities, they were challenging whether the Indian company was actually doing a lot of marketing in India. Was its functionality much wider than what was actually presented in the documentation? So during the second phase, we saw some more issues were raised by tax authorities, and you know, we were moving high on the learning curve. Then we moved to the third phase, which is from 2011 to 2015, which is until now. And there we saw a lot of litigation in some complex areas where it requires a lot of discussions, like whether Indian company was creating any intangibles in terms of doing advertising, marketing and promotional activities. And then there were some issues which were raised on the valuation of share capital, and also in other occasions where if the Indian company was considered more like a contracts software service provider, was that leading to any intangible creation in India? And then this period also saw that the tax authorities, they were referring a lot to the OECD guidance. They were also taking notes from the concepts which are emerging from the BEPS project. And in some cases, I also saw that the tribunal and the tax authorities, they were even referring to some international experience and cases while passing the judgment. So when I look at today, sitting today, I can say that you know, now in India, the debate is happening on all those issues which are today becoming more like global issues, and where emerging markets like India, they have a very significant stake. So that's how I look at the three phases, and the next phase, which I see from next year, I would see more litigation coming up in the areas which are highlighted by BEPS, specifically in transfer pricing. So it would be more in substance, value creation, and intangibles. So those would be the areas where we can see more litigation in the coming years. So, but on this slide, we have listed the issues which we have seen from the tax authorities over this last 15 years period, which started with the comparability analysis. It then went on to comparability adjustments. In very few cases, on location savings, because it's very difficult to quantify it, and especially when Indian subsidiary is not very big. So some very indirect methods was used to calculate whether India was getting any benefit from moving location of business to India. Then we have more complex issues like intangibles, R&D activities. Intra-group services in a big way, and in certain cases, even on financial transactions. Can we move to the next slide? So one, I don't know whether I should say benefit, but when Indian taxpayer opts for litigating the case, the payment of tax liability can be postponed. However, if the case, the judgment, when it is passed at a later stage by the relevant appellate authority, if it is passed against the taxpayer, then the taxpayer has to pay the tax demand along with the interest due on that tax demand for the period since when the tax was due, and it was not paid because the case was under litigation. So there's also an element of interest cost, and penalties are separate, you know, it's based on how much the serious offense is, and according to that, the penalty is levied. As Rajat discussed, that we have multiple channels to resolve disputes in India. We have today we have dispute resolution panels, CIT appeal, and then we go up to a tribunal, and we go to courts for legal matters. So I will not discuss on this in detail because my colleague Rajat covered this in his previous slide. Can you go to the next slide, please? Thanks. Issue of share capital. I still remember that when this issue came a couple of years back, we had a lot of discussion on this, you know, whether this is actually leading to any tax leakage from India. If a company issues share and the foreign company puts share capital in Indian company at certain price, say at $40 per share, and the tax officer claims that, you know, that should be $100. So that excess $60 is more like a loan which is given by Indian company to the foreign entity, and Indian company should get interest. But I think if I look at the issue of share capital, it was primarily coming from the way the TP regulation was understood by the people in India, especially the tax authorities, the way they were applying the TP regulations to share capital issue. But earlier this year, the High Court passed a judgment where they say that the infusion of capital by the foreign company as share capital into Indian company is not a loan transaction. So it's a pure equity transaction, and there is no leakage of taxes because of the infusion of capital into Indian company, and there is no tax avoidance. But the issue today is still there, that whether they should be classified as international transaction, and accordingly whether a taxpayer should be making disclosure in the form 3CB, which is a form which has to be filed along with the tax return. So that is one area. If disclosure is not made, there are penalty consequences. Second, whether the taxpayer is required to carry valuation exercise to prove that this is at arm's length, because the definition of international transaction is still very wide in India, and a non-disclosure can invite penalty. But if I am a taxpayer and if I have to take a decision, possibly I can decide to make a disclosure in my form 3CB as a note that there was such a transaction, but this has not been analyzed in detail because of the judgment which came in the past. And then at least I have done the compliance at the first level, and then wait for some more judgments which actually helps me in proving that this is actually not at all an international transaction. Can we move to next slide, please? Next issue is location saving, and this location saving is a very burning issue for emerging markets like India, China, where companies, they move operations to these countries primarily because of low cost. When I say primarily, this was primarily, say, 10 years back. But when we look at today, even the human cost, the salary cost of the people in India have gone up. But still, there are some cost advantages. It may be, for example, the land price, the utilities price, there can be still some cost savings. Now, the overall message we get from the tribunal on location saving is that the first step for the taxpayer to address location saving is to do right comparability analysis, which means that if the Indian company has certain advantages because of low cost, and if we have many similar players in India like the taxpayer, then we can say that it's more like a very competitive, it's a perfectly competitive market, which means there are many players in India. And so if Indian company doesn't provide those services, the foreign company can go to another service provider in India. So in that situation, I would not expect Indian company to get any savings because of location savings, more so when I have comparables to compare who are like me. So there was one case in early 2015 where the tribunal emphasized that it is important to look at the comparability analysis, and we should look for comparables. And in that given situation, there were appropriate comparables were available, and they said if comparables are there, one should not make any adjustments on account of location savings. And this comparability analysis preference is also being emphasized by the OECD in Action 8, where they say that if local comparables are available, no adjustment should be made because of location savings. However, on very few situations where the Indian company is the only player in India providing services, then the MNC should do this analysis and check how much location saving is there because of moving operations to India. And if that saving is not passed to the customer, then one has to, the company should evaluate that how much of that saving should go to India and how much should go to the foreign entity which has moved business to India. So this will be more based on bargaining, application of bargaining theory, applying economic tools to decide that how much is the saving in the first place, and how that should be shared between India and the foreign entity who has moved operations to India. Can we go to next slide, please? The third issue which I'm covering is on intangible. This is again a very very burning issue in India, and the case even went up to high courts. Although this was this appeared to be an economic issue, but then at legal grounds it went up to high court. And now the understanding we have now, especially after the high court judgment, the guidance is that intangible, when we look at intangible India, that primarily surrounds on advertising, marketing, and promotional spend which is incurred by the Indian distributor, for example. And so the taxpayer in India should not segregate this transaction and evaluate separately. And same message even goes to the tax authorities that the advertising, marketing, promotional function of the distributor should combine with other functionality of the distributor, and then we should look for comparables. And if we have comparables who are performing similar level of services like advertising, marketing, and promotional services or activities, rather activities, then the Indian taxpayer should not identify AMP as a separate transaction and look for an overall reward. And if the overall profits of the Indian distributors are at arm's length, which means they are in comparison to the comparables, then no adjustment should be made. However, if the taxpayer is unable to find comparables who are performing similar function as that taxpayer is performing in India, then one has to look for segregation of transactions, which means the advertising, marketing, and promotional activities in India could classify as performance of services for the benefit of the overseas parent. In that case, the taxpayer should look at applying a transparency method to check what is the arm's length reward on AMP services, and possibly he should go and apply a cost plus method where he should look for an appropriate markup on its cost. So that's what the overall guidance we have now, although we are still having litigation because this High Court judgment was on distribution, on cases where the Indian taxpayer was a distributor, but then we cannot apply the whole concept to manufacturing entities in India, because manufacturing entities, when they operate in India, they do a lot of value add, you know. They sometimes even develop local know-how. So there are a lot of elements which go into the profitability of the Indian manufacturers. But if I look at this, the whole issue from BEPS perspective, I think it is not very easy to resolve this issue just segregating AMP and, you know, looking for a markup. I think this issue possibly needs to be addressed more from the perspective of applying a profit split method. Because in this case, if the Indian company is doing certain activities like development, enhancement, or maintenance of the intangible in India by doing value-adding AMP activities, then it is creating intangibles locally and can be classified as the economic owner of those intangibles. So, and then, but at the group level, the group, the foreign entity is also developing all those intangibles which have global appeal and also appeal in India. So that is also leading to profits in India. So for that, the group company who owns the intangible, not only economically but also legally, should get some royalty. So I think we need to now apply, we used to use a two-sided approach, apply a profit split method and check whether the profitability of India is at arm's length. But the profit split method would be ideal in situations where the stakes are high, the transaction value is high, because application of such approach and methodology invite compliance costs for the taxpayer. Can you go to the next slide, please? The next issue which is which I'm covering is on management services, and this issue has picked up a lot of debate and discussion since 2009, and I remember that during those days I was helping my clients on some initial cases on management services adjustments, where the tax authorities in countries like France, they were expecting the head office to charge India because those costs, management costs which were incurred in France were benefiting India, and they say why France doesn't get a charge, get payments from India for the services. So that was the genesis of, you know, those charges starting flowing into India. But in those years, the major problem which I felt was that the Indian taxpayer did not maintain a required level of documentation. In many cases, I could not even substantiate my client case where we did not have a proper full allocation sheet which says that why this amount is being charged to India, what were the right allocation keys. All those things were missing in the initial days of discussion with the tax authorities. And by the time we were able to produce that, you know, the tax inspector had made his mind. And then the next level we went to justifying the benefit test, which means whether the taxpayer is receiving any benefits from those charges. So one is I pay those charges, it's fine. You know, I can prove that through some submitting some invoices, submitting the allocation sheet. But what about the benefits? So this case has been litigated extensively in India. Now the current guidance is that specifically after the High Court ruling again on this topic also, where it is not necessary to show that there was an extreme necessity for receiving services by the Indian taxpayer. So if India has received services, Indian taxpayer doesn't need to demonstrate that there was a need of services. And that was something which was required, which was expected from the tax authorities, that Indian taxpayer should demonstrate the need. Now, the question now the taxpayer has to address is that, first of all, that there should be enough documentation to prove that the right charges paid by the Indian taxpayer. Second is that we should also have some examples to substantiate that the Indian taxpayer is receiving benefits. So it is not necessary to say that I received a good profits this year, every year I receive good profits, but on an overall basis I should be able to demonstrate that I'm receiving benefits. And the High Court judgment says that, you know, it is not always necessary to show that it is resulting in the increase in profit or income for the taxpayer. But the critical level of documentation would be to substantiate that Indian company is receiving benefits, and also that there's enough level of documentation to prove that the allocation which was made to India was appropriate and at arm's length. Can you move to next slide, please? Next issue we have is on contract R&D, and this issue was also in discussion 5 to 6 years back, if I recollect. And there was one case where the Indian tax inspector he claimed that the Indian contract R&D or service provider or Indian contract software service provider was was a main entity in creating of patents which are filed in the U.S. And then we had the ruling came from the CBDT on contract R&D. The rules were given where what markups are to be expected, what type of methodology is to be expected for contract R&D. Now, the key message is that, first of all, when we look at contract R&D, the taxpayer, if is receiving a cost-plus markup, then he has to demonstrate that there are some guidance which is coming from the overseas entity who's actually taking the benefits of this contract R&D, who owns the intellectual property. So there should be a decision-making power at the foreign entity level. The foreign entity should be able to control risk, which means that if tomorrow the R&D work is not done properly, then foreign entity can guide the Indian company. And then also the foreign company should have a financial capacity to fund the R&D activities in India. But if I take an outlier case where all decisions are made in India, the new concepts are decided in India, then it will be very difficult to apply a cost-plus kind of an approach for a contract R&D player in India. And in that situation, the tax inspector in India will expect allocation of profits to the Indian contract R&D service provider, and that would lead to application of profit split method. So the profit attribution will be much higher than giving a cost plus to the contract R&D service provider in India. Can you go to next slide, please? So now, what is important for the taxpayer to do to address these issues impacting him? One is that the taxpayer should have a robust documentation in place. That is the key thing, which means that if a profit split method has been applied, then taxpayer should provide substantive documentation from from the parent side and also from India side to justify why this method was applied. Where if Indian company is a contract service provider, then it should document and able to justify that that a lot of significant people functions were taken place in foreign location, which are in terms of taking the overall decision, controlling the risk, and also having the financial capacity to fund the contract R&D services in India. But when I look at the way the law has changed, which Rajat also discussed in previous slides, that now we have a range concept. There's a flexibility now with the taxpayer. We also have a multiple year concept, which means if taxpayer is having not having good profits in 1 year, one can look for multiple year approach to justify that this 1 year low profits is because of specific situation and that is not because of my dealings with my related party. Can you move to the next slide, please? So, but when we look at from an overall perspective, that one is for a taxpayer, compliance is important. But then compliance is there. Then if tomorrow, if taxpayer prepares a robust documentation, then does taxpayer still expect to face a heavy litigation cost? But when I look at today, looking at how proactive the AP authorities are in solving, agreeing the AP agreements, when I look at how the DRP appeal mechanism has improved over the years, and when I look at that, the government is also working towards putting the mutual agreement procedure on fast track. So if I look at all those these positive things, I think my view is that in the coming years, I can expect that there will be a rational judgment from the tax authorities in terms of looking at the trespassing case with the required tools, but at the same time applying the arm's length principle. And if the taxpayer has the right level of documentation, then I would not expect that the taxpayer case being dragged up to the highest appellate level. But at the same time, maintaining key robust documentation will be key. And especially post BEPS, we have now action point 8.10, which is emphasize on the substance, what substance the Indian company has in terms of significant people function, what values created by the Indian company, who's controlling the risk. All those concepts will be used by tax authorities to check that whether the Indian company is only a cost center, whether Indian company is only a revenue center, or whether Indian company is more like a profit and investment center, because it is actually carrying out a lot of significant people function and hence creating intellectual property or intangibles in India. So from a governance side, I would feel that we would see a better litigation framework for taxpayer in India, but at the same time, because we have so much knowledge is there now from BEPS, it will be important for the taxpayer to maintain right level of documentation so that it can address all those points which were also put forward by the OECD in the BEPS project. So with that, I close my presentation and Rajat, do you have any final concluding remarks on our today's topic?
So coming from key measures to mitigate litigation, I think there has been a recent internal guideline to from the CBDT to tax authorities that they should not be mechanical in referring cases for transfer pricing audit. Only if they see a risk area really an audit is required, then only they should conduct that transfer pricing audit. Earlier, what used to happen, there was an internal guideline that anything above 15 crores need to be audited, but they have now brought in a guideline where they have given a leeway to that, where they say that only where there is a risk of tax addition, or where there is a risk, then only you should basically audit that. So I think this is something very positive, and we are moving towards the positive positivity, and we shall see reduction in mitigation and reduction in litigation in future.
Yeah, absolutely right, Rajat. I think, you know, as I said, we are moving to phase four now, and given the guidance which has come out from the BEPS action points, you know, preparing the right level of documentation will be key. And if there are right arguments which are there which substantiate the actual conduct of the parties, then I think the case for the taxpayer will be strong in case if it goes with, in litigation, if the tax inspector challenged the intercompany transactions.
Yes.
So this marks the end of our presentation. I would request anyone in the audience who has any questions to type them in the comment box as of now.
Rajat, one question which I give to you is that if a taxpayer has to decide to go for safe harbor or APA, and if a, this taxpayer is a cost plus entity, so which route would you recommend?
So, you know, the answer is very simple, you know, considering, you know, the safe harbor percentages and, you know, the mechanical provisions of safe harbor, I will always suggest an APA. But then also, you know, it also depends on the facts of the case, you know, if, and the cost-benefit analysis which the taxpayer will internally do.
Okay. Next question is that the commissioners in the DRP panel, are they a TP specialist, or do they have a wider functionality? Like, they, do they also look after the tax cases?
Yeah. So, you know, earlier, you know, we used to have, you know, TPOs basically, you know, having additional charge for DRPs. So now, you know, government lately have come out with the specialist commissioners, you know, who are going to look into the DRP panel, and they are going to have a separate and independent charge so that, you know, the DRP process can be more robust. So yes, you know, the, now they are it's a separate department altogether.
Okay. Rajat, the next question is that which method is used the most in India? Is it a transaction net margin method, or a profit split method, or an RPM method, or a CUP method?
So, you know, this is totally fact-based, you know, but we have seen, you know, other method now being used lately, you know, because taxpayer wants a flexibility in fixing its prices. So I will not say, you know, whether TNMM is more used, or, you know, obviously, you know, if you have, you know, TNMM, although, you know, statistically has been used, but I will not, you know, classify that whether TNMM is statistically more used or RPM is used. It's all fact-based thing. Yeah. But other method, yes, you know. You know, if you are, you want a flexibility in justifying your prices, other method is being lately used.
Yeah, thanks, Rajat. Another question from the audience is that what is normal margin expected in APAs from cost plus entity vis-a-vis safe harbor? And I will answer this question, Rajat, and you can add. I think when we look at a cost plus entity, the margin, there is no fixed margin for a cost plus entity, but yes, if this entity is from the IT sector, then we know that there are specific markups, you know, which are there based on the experience from doing benchmarking analysis, benchmarking search. Yeah, but this cost, markup for the cost plus entity would be based more on the comparability analysis, benchmarking analysis, and I expect that if the taxpayer is a routine player, a cost center, then I would not expect that his markup will be touching the markup expected in safe harbor, because in safe harbor the markups are generally high because the taxpayer want to get a certainty, but that markup may not be an arm's length markup, right? So it can be high and it may not be arm's length, but it's agreed because the law has given that option, and if the taxpayer chooses that option, then he actually doesn't face any litigation in the future, right? So though both are different, and the markup will vary from APA to safe harbor.
So Virendra, just to add, you know, safe harbor is a very mechanical provision, and APA requires negotiation, and is a wider concept than safe harbor.
Yeah. And Rajat, next question we have is that, shall we go ahead with valuation exercise in case of issue of equity of shares by an Indian company, especially after one of one child ruling?
So, you know, considering, you know, government's stand on issue of share capital, you know, they have not decided to appeal the High Court's decision, and High Court's decision is very clear that, you know, they do not consider the share issue as an international transaction because there is no element of income in it. So the element of income should be present under the gamut of Indian income tax law. So if there is no element of income, then I don't foresee, you know, any litigation arising on the equity shares in future, considering that, you know, we have a new government in place and they are more, tax friendly, I must say, you know, but there won't be any litigation. So I don't think, you know, this will require another exercise.
Yeah. Thanks, Ajit.
Thank you everyone for attending. This is the end of our webinar. A recording of the session along with the slides used just before we stop, we've just received one more question that we will address before finishing. The question is, which will be the best method if a foreign company is charging Indian subsidiary on the basis of per employee? Example, foreign company charging Indian marketing and development subsidiary $10,000 per employee doing such services.
Oh, I think if I just look at this case, you know, this is more like a kind of a variable rate, which is variable rate in the sense that $10,000 per employee, and then if there are more employees, then the charge will increase. Not variable in the sense that the rate will keep changing, but in terms of that, the fee will change as per how many employees are there. But the best method would be here a comparable and controlled price method, but it's very difficult to find that method. Now, before we discuss of applying any method, we have to understand that what is the profile of the service provider. If it's a cost center, which means it is responsible for ensuring that it recovers its cost, then I would possibly look for a cost plus or a modified transaction net margin method. If it's a revenue center, there also I could possibly use a transaction net margin method, but specifically look for the functionality of this service provider. But then if the foreign company is a profit center, which means that it is charging $10,000 per employee, but it's performing a much wider level of activities, then one can move to a profit split. But to take a conclusion on this, I think it's difficult to find a cup method. So I invariably, in all practical for all practical purposes, we would land up in looking for some kind of a markup on cost if it is not actually if it is not actually doing a substantial value addition.
I hope all of your questions have been answered satisfactorily. If you would like any more information about this topic, please feel free to contact the details of the persons mentioned on the screen right now. I would also like to mention that this recording of this webinar will be available on TPA Global's website, along with the slides used, which also contains the details of the presenters. Thank you everyone for attending and wish you a very good evening.
Thanks.
Thanks.